everyone, welcome to Cross Culture Critic. I'm Chris.
And I'm Joe.
Welcome. How you doing, man?
I'm hanging in. How about you?
I'm good, good. Yeah, had the day off work today. It was nice. I kind of did a little staycation today. So you get a few days off in the week each week, right?
Yeah. Okay. My weekend is Wednesday, Thursday.
Okay. Do you have kids home on Wednesday or Thursday?
Not unless it's summer.
Nice.
During the school year, Wednesday, Thursdays, that's just off. I have no obligations.
That's nice.
Yeah.
I always have kids home. So today was kind of going to be a nice day of relaxing around the house, and then my son got sick. But he watched TV, and I just stay in the other room and relax. But I thought maybe to kick it off, I would ask, you know, if you had a day off work, no obligations. It sounds like sometimes you get to have that.
Yeah.
What's the best way to spend it?
Can I ask this question first?
Mm-hmm.
Is it one whole thing or different things?
No, perfect day.
See, the perfect day for me is waking up, having a good cup of tea,
mm-hmm.
and reading my Bible to start the day off.
Okay.
And then after that, I think I enjoy going to the zoo. I have a zoo pass.
Nice.
So I like to go to the zoo, walk around, get a little exercise, see what's going on when it's not crowded in the morning. And then I enjoy some drop-in ice hockey. After that would be a good lunch, and then some video games in the afternoon, followed by, if my girls are with me that day, doing something fun in the evening with them, or if they're not with me and I can, you know, get some free time with my girlfriend, you know, hanging out with her, binge-watching some shows and enjoying some good wine.
Nice. You're a much nicer person than I am, because my perfect day includes no one else.
No.
and maybe it's just because I'm at home so often with the kids, and it's just like, if I have a day off, I kind of want some me time.
Yeah.
I would definitely, I love going out to breakfast.
That's a good one.
It might be like I'm turning into my dad, because he would always do that. But I love, if I have a day off and I've dropped the kid, my daughter off at daycare and my son's off at school, I will go get some breakfast, nice eggs and bacon, coffee.
Yeah, no, you're right. That's definitely, if I could go back, it would be wake up and do the Bible, then go grab breakfast, then head to the zoo. Because that is a thing that I enjoy doing.
I'd probably go home, read a little bit, read a lot. I like to read a lot. Journal a bit. And then I think I would go find a coffee shop in Ann Arbor. I love Ann Arbor. We used to live there, and I miss it terribly. And I'd go find a coffee shop, read and write for a bit, maybe do some blogging or, you know, write on whatever writing project I'm on at that point. Maybe see a movie. I'd probably see a movie. Walk around. I'd love walk around that town. And then probably find another coffee shop and just sit there. That's my favorite thing to do, is just sit in a coffee shop with the laptop open or a good book and let time pass very slowly.
Oh, nice.
And I'd have to go to Zingerman's and get a Reuben.
That's legit.
When I lived in Ann Arbor, we lived about 3 miles off the downtown, and the greatest week of my life, I took a staycation, and on Monday, I walked 3 miles down to Zingerman's, got a Reuben, and walked all the way back. A couple days later, walked 3 miles down to Blimpy Burger, got a burger, walked all the way back. It was great.
And it equals itself out.
It did, exactly. It was hot, so I was sweating.
You walked 6 miles, you walked it all off.
It was great.
Well, the thing that did remind me is when you said breakfast. You know something that I've brought back from Hawaii that I didn't physically bring it back. Mentally, I've brought it back, is in Hawaii, one morning, we were like, let's get breakfast. So we ordered breakfast, and my girls got pancakes, and my girlfriend's daughter got French toast, and my girlfriend got eggs and bacon. Well, I got this stuff that they do in Hawaii where it's fried rice.
Okay.
But it's breakfast fried rice. So it's rice, it's got a little bit of bacon in it, little onion, and some egg. And
they put it in a bowl
and it just comes in a bowl, and then you can put soy sauce on it.
Oh, nice.
And so I got that because I saw it on the menu. I'm like, that looks good. So they're all like, what are you, what did you get? So I told them, they're like, that sounds disgusting.
That sounds amazing.
They all tried it. They loved it. So I did get to finish it though. So the next time, a few days go by, let's get breakfast again. What do you guys want? Hey, can we, my girl's like, can we order from that place you got the other day? I'm like, yeah, that's fine. I ordered it. Mia ordered it. Ella ordered it. My girlfriend Molly ordered it. Four orders of, you know, of this fried breakfast rice. And her daughter got, you know, the French toast again. But it was so good. I've now come back. And one of the things I love to do is Trader Joe's. They have, like, frozen bags of, like, brown rice. And they're dirt cheap. I think you get three bags for, like, $2 or three bags for $3. And I just get those. You pop them in the microwave for, like, 4 minutes. And then I'll heat up some, you know, some bacon or something.
Oh, so you'll make it.
And I make it.
You dump the soy sauce on it.
I do. It's nice. So simple and it's so good. It fills you up. So I'll, you know, on my days off, I'll eat it like 9 a.m. and then I'm not hungry till like 3 p.m. because it just like sticks with you.
Yeah, there is nothing better than a good breakfast.
Yeah.
Like, I wish we had money and time to be brunch people. Because one year I decided to go all fancy with Kelly and I got us reservations at the Whitney for brunch.
Oh yeah.
And it was amazing. Like it was one of the best meals I've ever had. And yeah, I nothing else to say except I love brunch.
We could do a whole episode on breakfast.
That would be a Ron Swanson episode. That we'll have to do that one day. But one thing I've noticed recently, the episodes that seem to get the most traction and excitement tend to be our CCM episodes.
Oh yeah.
Where we're talking about contemporary Christian music and the Christian
as they should.
We get a lot of feedback and a lot of listens on those. So we're going to start doing something new occasionally. I don't know if it's going to be a monthly thing, but, you know, every once in a while we'll pick out an album and we'll talk about it.
And feel free to email in or post on Facebook an album that you want us to review or something like that that we could talk about.
And we'll have to do an insiders one sometime.
Oh, for sure.
I think that would be amazing. You get to talk about, like, all your magic.
Yeah.
You know, your songwriting magic. And I think in April we'll have to do an Amy Grant one for reasons we'll talk about in April.
Yeah.
But this week what we decided to talk about was maybe the first Christian rock album. Rock is kind of soft, but...
Yeah.
Contemporary Christian album I ever heard, I think. And that is Michael W. Smith's Eye to Eye. Did you hear this when it came out? Which was, I believe, late 80s. It was...
I did, because I was a youth group
88.
Kid.
Okay.
I was a youth group kid. All right. So you'd go to youth group on Wednesday night. You'd go up. The youth group room was open. Mm-hmm. Foosball was being played. We had some video games in there. The old arcade. Like, not...
Yeah.
You know, not console, like the old arcade games. We had foosball. We had
air hockey. Where did you go to church?
Woodlawn.
Wow.
Which
nice.
Is now Woodside Royal Oak Campus.
Okay.
But so at Woodlawn, and, you know, they always had music playing, and this album got played a lot. So that's where I was introduced to it.
This is a good album. 1988, it's his fourth album. I did not realize that.
I did not either.
Like, I thought he came out of the gate with this one, but no, he did. The Michael W. Smith Project, which is the one with Friends on it, and I think Great is the Lord. Michael W. Smith 2.
Okay.
Okay, which I don't get. The Big Picture, which is, I listened to that a few weeks ago, and that is a really good album.
Really?
It's like his really 80s, like, rockin' album. I like that one a lot. But definitely aim towards the youth group crowd, because all the songs are, like, about don't have sex! And no, pursue your dreams.
Yeah, that's always a good hook.
Yeah, yeah. So, but Eye to Eye was probably his first really big one, I would say.
Because of the second track.
Because the second track, which we'll get to, we're going to go through this track by track. Yeah. I remember hearing it. My parents went and saw Amy Grant in concert, and he opened for her.
Oh, okay.
Because he used to be her keyboard player, and they wrote a lot of songs together. So he ended up opening for her. And they liked him better than Amy Grant, so they came home with his album. So I remember them listening to it, and I didn't have any, like, 88, I would have been 9 years old, so I didn't have any inkling of, oh, there's such thing as Christian music and secular music. It was just my parents' music. But I loved that thing. And so we'll get right into it. The first track on it, though, we were talking about this offline. When you hear the harmonica chords on Hand of Providence at the very beginning, that took me back to 9 years old in my family room.
When you sent me, you know, a couple weeks ago, you sent me the show topics and things like that. You said, we're going to review this album. We're going to do a flashback and do it. I was like, oh, Lord. Like, the last thing I want to do is, like, listen to this old school corny album.
Mm-hmm.
And so what I did was, you know, I was like, okay, well, I got to listen to it. And I jumped in the shower, turned on the old Bluetooth speaker, press play on this album. And, you know, good old iTunes streaming. And so as soon as I get in the shower, press play, Hand of Providence starts. And I was literally taken back 20-some years to, you know, more than that, 30-some years.
30 years.
You know, to 1988, hearing it. And that song, I have to say, and I'm probably going to say this on a lot of these songs, it stands strong to like today.
Yeah.
Like, it doesn't seem dated. The message is fantastic. The message is not presented in a corny way. I thought Hand of Providence, his voice on it, and just the way he rings that out, Providence, like, perfect. Like, it's perfect right out of the gate. I was like, because I was thinking, you know, the second song was going to be like it, and that was it. And Providence right out of the gate, and I'm like, this is amazing. To where I even added it to other playlists.
Oh, really?
That I've been listening to.
Yeah. I'm a sucker for any time someone can take a one-syllable word and stretch it out to seven. Like, hey, and. I like that. Like,
hey, yeah, Providence.
Well, what's so funny is, like, now Michael W. Smith is so known as, like, America's worship pastor, which I should also point out, I think when we were talking about Christian music a few weeks ago, I said I wanted Michael W. Smith to make a comeback. He has two albums coming out this month.
Oh, really?
One comes out actually on February 16th. So last week, it's already out. It's his pop album. And then at the end of the month, he has a worship album coming out.
Wow.
Yeah, so he's still going strong.
What else can you speak into existence?
Yeah, I know.
It'd be great if my bank account was...
I would really like Perfect Strangers to make a comeback.
Oh, Lord. Hey, guess what? Netflix just announced Balky Bartokomis is...
Behind the Balky.
Right.
But, you know, now you think of Michael W. Smith and he's like the worship leader. But he was like kind of a pop star. I don't know who I would compare him to. Maybe like a Billy Joel, or did he play piano?
Yeah.
Phil Collins.
You know what? I don't want to say he was Billy Joel, but he was definitely, the name escapes me. The guy who sings, I love L.A., and all the
Randy Newman.
Randy Newman.
Yes. Okay. Yeah.
I see Michael W. Smith as Randy Newman. Wrote great songs. Had the voice that when you hear Randy Newman sing, you know it's Randy Newman. He wrote phenomenal songs over decades. Mm-hmm. You know, not like, oh, he was big for these 5 years. He's still writing great songs. And same thing with Michael W. Smith. He was that piano, but not the rockin' piano like Billy Joel, Elton John. He was the Randy Newman.
Yeah, yeah. And you know what? In recent years, I feel like his voice, he's tried to make it more mellow and kind of lost that nasally aspect. Mm-hmm. And I'm like, it's not Michael W. Smith. And it doesn't.
We want nasally.
Yes. If he doesn't sound like he has a cold, it's not Michael W. Smith. But I dug the song. Like I've talked about before, I went through a Calvinist phase in my 20s, a really strong Calvinist phase. And Providence was always the word. You didn't have luck. You didn't say good luck. You said good Providence.
Ooh.
You know, because we were legalistic like that. So I love this song because he's talking about Providence the whole time. But I also think it's also the first Christian, like, pop song I ever heard.
Yeah.
This one took me back. I still like it. Like you said, it's not overly preachy. I think there are a few on this album that might get that way. But
yeah,
we'll talk about those. It's a really good kickoff to this album. It's a lot of fun. But... Secret Ambition, track two, is really the one.
That's the one.
That is a good song. When you hear those drums kick in. And
the very first, like, Michael W. Smith's voice, just, young man up on the hillside. And you're like, dude. And I remember being a kid, and, like, this was the song, this one and Great Adventure by Stephen Curtis Chapman. These were the two songs that, like, those late 80s, every, like, youth video you watched had this going in the background.
Yep.
On Easter, you'd play this video.
Because it was the crucifixion.
It was the crucifixion. Yep. So it would have all that, you know, those drums and everything.
Yep.
And you know, on Easter, they'd play it and all that stuff. And so the song just, it was in so many other things that I think it got to the point where you're like, okay, enough. And almost became... like a joke, like a punchline for decades. Well, after being a punchline for decades, and then you hear it, it's you're good. Like, this is legit.
Yes, because, okay, well, here's the funny thing, too, is I went through this whole phase where I'm like, every Christian music song is so preachy, they just need to make it a little more vague. And then they started making it vague, where I'm like, I don't know if you're talking about Jesus or a girl. And, like, this is one where, you know, no one's going to nudge you and say, he's talking about Jesus. Like, no, he's talking about Jesus, and it's a rock song about Jesus.
Right, and it's a good one.
It's a good one, and I like it, and it's not, you know, you got to ask him into your heart and go to heaven. Right, it's, like, actually about Jesus, which is still, I'm kind of amazed it's got, like, MTV play.
Yeah, it's got, like, it's chronologically sound as far as the verses and chorus go. And it's just, it's fantastic. It's a fantastic song.
One thing I did notice, and I think it's, like, on this album, all the songs go on way too long, though.
They do.
And, like, there's, like, 2 whole minutes of at the end of him just, like, no, no, no!
right. Yeah, I don't know what's up with that part, but as far as the meat of the song goes, it's pretty good, and the hook is fantastic.
Now, I have to say, I have permission from Michael W. Smith to remake this song.
Ooh.
When I was 8, I was in a Christian band with my cousins. We're called the Christian Brothers.
Okay.
Even though we were cousins, so I don't really get that. But my cousins went to a signing, a CD signing he was given, and asked if we could rewrite one of his songs. To be, nobody knows when he's coming back.
Oh.
And we never did it. And so that aspiring songwriters, that's open to you. so that's how influential that song was. That is
amazing. I'm trying to pull up the album. Because as we're talking, I want to see like what the next ones are. So I'm trying to pull it up on my phone here.
Yeah, I think if you go to Wikipedia, it should have the whole playlist. Oddly enough, I've seen him in concert quite a bit, and I swear he's only played this song live once when I've seen him.
Oh, seriously?
Yeah.
Because he's probably sick of playing it.
Well, now everything is like, above all powers. So, but yeah, that's one of the top 5 great Christian songs, I think. I think that's up there.
See, we're going to have one problem going through this. I don't associate songs with titles.
Okay.
So as we like get to each one, I'm looking at some of these and I'm like, I know I like them, but I can't remember how it goes.
Well, here's an easy way to think of the next 3. On the Other Side, All You're Missing Is a Heartache, I Miss the Way. All 3 songs are about the exact same thing. Michael W. Smith has a friend. Michael W. Smith becomes a Christian. He's living differently. He's on the other side.
Okay.
I used to walk ashore, but I'm not there anymore. I'm on the other side. His friend is
Wait,
still...
Wait, sing the chorus again? Oh, no, I know. Because I'm on the other side. Wait, how... I'm on the other...
I don't know. I'm getting it screwed up because I think there's a song...
I know it in my head. It's not coming out right.
There's a song with that same title in The Greatest Showman. Okay. And I've been hearing that on the soundtrack, and I get them all mixed up. But it's like, true, I used to walk your shore.
Yes.
Yeah.
But I'm not there anymore. Yeah.
So it tells a story.
I love that song, too.
It's a good...
That was great.
They're all catchy, but I was listening, like, this is the same thing. Like, On the Other Side is, I used to run with you. But now I don't because I'm a Christian, and I don't do that.
And I don't talk to non-Christians anymore.
Yeah, but his friend is going to keep going this way. And he's going to keep living like an unbeliever. And Michael W. Smith is like, yeah, you're going to have all this. You're going to have this. You know what? Next song, All You're Missing Is a Heartache.
Yeah.
And it's like, whoa.
And All You're Missing Is a Heartache, I hate it.
It's a bad song.
That's the song on the album that when I was listening to it, and again, I didn't know, like... I would just turn it on the Bluetooth, take a shower, play video games, and turn the TV down and, you know, turn the speaker up. So while I'm playing video games, I'm listening to it. So I don't know music. I don't know titles of songs. I was just hearing it. I'm like, I love this song, love this song, love this song. And then
all
you're missing is a heartache.
All you're missing is a heartache.
I'm like, this is terrible. Like, it's one I don't like on the album.
Well, it's okay. This whole theme, too, kind of gets a little preachy because he's like kind of self-righteous. He's like, I'm on the other side.
He was allowed to be. It was the late 80s.
And by the way, you're going to get a little heartache from what you're doing. And now you've gone so far that next song, I Miss the Way. You know, the Father is missing you. And I guess I like this song. Like it's a little sad song, and you can like when I was a teenager, I would listen to this song and use it as a way to judge all my friends who had like abandoned Christ, and like, oh, but the Father, he's missing you too. He sheds a tear for you. But it's actually
you see what you have to do on every single one of these. You have to refresh me with
this. This is gonna be the most singing I've ever done in my life.
So what is
I miss the way his love would dance within your eyes. He gets really hot.
I can't remember this one. Oh, are we allowed to play them or can we not?
I think fair use lets you play it.
Does it?
Yeah. So, but this is a slow. This is like a piano ballad.
So I want to. Oh. I know. Yes. We're just taking a second here, people.
It's sad.
I love this one, too.
Yeah.
I love this one, too.
I had a best friend in high school who we led a Bible study together. We went to the same church. We lived right around the block from each other. So we led a Bible study in school. And after high school, after I graduated, he graduated, we kind of went our separate ways. And he ended up, he came out of the closet and things like that. And this song I'd always play and think of, this is Jason. I missed the way. And I don't know if you've ever seen the video for this. There's a video to this.
Oh, is there?
And it's like the guy is like coming back from a baseball game. I think he's got a mullet. And like, yeah.
Well, of course he did, because Michael W. Smith did.
Yeah. Did Michael W. Smith? I know. Stephen Curtis Chapman had one. But yeah, Michael W. Smith set his piano in like a high school gymnasium while there's this orchestra around and he's singing about how much he misses his friend. And I like the song, but it's also like this whole progression is Michael W. Smith is like, I'm a Christian, you're not. You're gonna have all these consequences, which I agree with, but I'm like kind of preachy. And then like, I miss how much you love Jesus. And I actually do get that because I have a lot of friends who have left the faith. And so, on the one hand, I can joke about it and laugh that he's kind of getting preachy.
Mm.
But I totally get the fact that there are people who I grew up with who were so, like, I don't like this phrase, but on fire for God. That, and now they're, like, atheists or agnostic.
Yeah,
and that makes me sad.
Yeah,
like that
absolutely.
Really, yeah, that really makes me sad. There's a, even, like, there's a singer I really like, Derek Webb. I've talked about him before. Great songwriter. And he was kind of the soundtrack to my 20s. He was part of Caden's Call. And now he's, he's hosting a podcast about how he's an agnostic and things like that. And you're like, Derek, I miss the way he's not, So that's I Miss the Way. It's a good song. It's a pretty little ballad. But then he gets into his, like, rocking a little bit again with Live and Learn.
Live and Learn. So let me play a little bit of this one.
Oh, this has an awesome opening.
Okay, here we go.
It's got the wind. It's
so we pray, our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name.
Little kid stuff going on.
Tis the blink of an eye.
Oh.
Tis the draught of a breath.
Oh, the rapture.
But then it goes right into.
Yeah, that's not a good one.
That's
I'm not a big fan.
But
of
I do like that opening. I love the dramatic and why shouldn't that be so proud?
I remember asking my mom, when I was younger and they were playing that everywhere. I went and bought the cassette tape of this, and I would listen to tapes as I went to sleep. And I remember when that song came on, I would be terrified every night because that beginning would come on and I'd be trying to sleep.
It's like Vincent Price and Thriller.
Yeah, exactly. That was exactly it.
Hounds of Hell.
So now we go on to the next one, which
I Hear Leisha, which is like his Make Him Cry song.
Yeah, which I never really listened to the words, I guess, or I was too young to care. Mm-hmm. And so when I was listening to this now as a 40-year-old, I'm thinking, like, this song's brutal.
Yeah, this is about basically a girl who dies.
Yeah.
And that's really it.
And it sounds like somebody's child.
Yeah.
Like somebody, well, obviously everybody's somebody's child, but it sounds like Leisha was a young child, and he's almost like singing to the parents.
Yeah.
And I'm like, oh, this one's brutal.
It's a tearjerker. I remember we did a youth group musical when I was a teenager. And
was it a Hell House?
It wasn't a Hell House. It was not a Hell House. But it was centered around these teens mourning the death of their friend, and this was like the song at the end.
Oh.
Like, you know, to make people come to the altar and stuff like that. Everyone had to have that like sad song.
Yeah. No, I get it. I mean, even the Insiders, we, you know, try to do a little sad song here or there, maybe. Maybe we didn't.
Yeah, I don't remember. Sad. But yeah, like Stephen Chris Chapman always had songs about, like, you know, God is God, I am not, and stuff like that. But I like this because it's kind of, I feel like Christians try to gloss over death and, you know, like, just focus on heaven and don't mourn too much. And it's like, no, mourn. This is a sad song, but you're looking for it. I don't know. Is funeral songs a thing? Like,
yeah, okay. Yeah, they actually are.
I mean, you'd have to be very specific about who died with this, because
right.
if Janet dies, I'm not going to play I Hear Leisha unless I change the lyrics.
Right.
But
Leisha is an odd name.
I feel like it has to be Alicia.
Yeah.
But like, he's very casual. It's a very casual way to refer to someone at their funeral.
Yeah.
So.
Or is he saying Lisa and I'm not hearing
it
right?
No, it's Leisha. It's L-E-E-S-H-A.
Right.
So, you know, it must be a dear friend. That's all I can think.
Yeah.
I hear Leisha. But that's a sad song. And that's, you know, that was kind of the stock and trade. The next one is my least favorite one on the album, Help You Find a Way.
I like it.
Really?
Yeah. Help You Find a Way. Yeah. So, like, I'll play a little.
I feel like it's his arena song.
Yeah.
Okay, maybe it's not horrible. Okay. You would be at a concert. Joe has his hands up swaying in the air right now. That is exactly, you would have like 15-year-olds swaying around at
yep.
this and chanting it back.
I like that song.
I get it. It might be my least favorite, but I like this album.
You it's less than All You're Missing Is a Heartache?
Oh, you might. Okay. I don't know. I like it when he's like, All You're Missing Is a Heartache. Like, I don't know. You can shout that.
Yo.
I guess you can also shout, I'll help you find
But
a
it's
way.
So judgy. All You're Missing
is
a Heartache.
It is.
It's kind of a brutal thing to say to someone.
But then they all gang up on the person at the end, too, because it's like five people going, All You're missing is a heartache.
Yeah, but then what's nicer going, I'll help you find your way.
That's true. Okay. Like, it's a little more friendship song. This is him returning to his friend.
Right, right.
Unless his friend was Leisha, in which that's awkward.
Yeah.
I feel like the next one is kind of, like, it's not my favorite on the album, but it's the coolest one. Ashton.
Okay.
It's the instrumental track.
See, instrumentals, I don't like. Insiders, we did an instrumental once.
Mm-hmm.
And the only reason it was an instrumental is because I couldn't think of lyrics to put
okay.
to it. And I kind of think that's what artists do, like, as a filler.
Oh, see, no, because I know the story behind this one.
Oh, so tell us.
Are you aware what Ashton is?
Ashton Kutcher?
No, well, okay, that makes it kind of cool. First off, you'll notice this sounds
kind of cool.
But you'll notice there's kind of like an action movie to this,
okay.
sound to this, where it's like,
okay.
This is, do you remember the book, This Present Darkness?
Yeah.
Ashton, it came out 3 years before this album came out. Ashton is the town in that book. Where, and if you're not familiar with the book, This Present Darkness, it's like 30 years old, so you might not be. It is a book about like a town where there's a cult coming in or something like that. And so people are praying against this cult. But the story also takes place like in the spiritual realm where angels and demons are fighting. So this is kind of a concept spiritual warfare thing.
Okay.
Which is kind of, I think that there's not enough like weird concept stuff in Christian music. But I also remember this because I went to like 3 different churches where they would take this song and do a dance. It was the only time you could dance at a Baptist church, was you were doing an interpretive dance where it's the angels against the demons. And,
oh.
and it was cool to like it because they were having like a sword fight or something.
Oh.
And it's like, you know, they're just...
And it starts with...
It starts very creepy, kind of like a horror movie.
Oh. Oh. Again, these two songs, I was like listening to this as a child...
Yeah.
And it just got to be where it was like, almost scary to listen to this at night to go to bed.
It's really scary when you're sitting in a Baptist church and people are in like black pajamas, like dancing at
fighting the angels.
Yeah, because like this is
and
like
you're like, who's gonna win?
This is like where the demons are like coming in and like crouching at the side of the stage.
What happens if the dancers just decided to like, you know what, today the demons are winning?
That would be scary.
And they just defeated.
Oh, that's right. Because there was also they would also do it. There would be just a kid in the middle of the stage in regular clothes, and that was whose soul they were fighting over.
Right.
Yeah.
I'm sure at one point they're hanging onto one arm, and
that,
angel,
I can
and
guarantee
it gets, and it gets like pulled like the jerking to both sides.
I guarantee
the rhythmic jerking to both sides.
That sounds weird.
That should have been on our last episode.
But yeah, I went to like three churches where they would do that. And I think it sounds cool. I kind of dig it. The next to last is The Throne, which is kind of one of his early worship songs.
The Throne.
Blessing, glory, sing, Ali.
Oh, yes. Yeah. Yes.
And I kind of, we would always sing this after the speech or after the sketch. Because, like, then the angels win and we're in heaven where everyone's, like, praising God.
Yeah, this is a great song,
this is
man.
A good worship song.
Dude, you picked a phenomenal album to review.
This is a good album.
We need to hype this more.
We did. We have to.
Hopefully, we'll see Smitty on the 4th of August.
I hope so. Oh, and we will play this for him.
Oh, well, and. Yeah.
But this is the 30-year anniversary of this album, too. He's got to do a tour.
Oh, he's got to. He's got to.
But, like, The Throne, I legit like as a worship song because so many worship songs, I've heard them called, like, 24-7s. Or, no, 7-11 songs. You sing the same seven words 11 times. Like, that's what all modern worship seems to be. And this is actually, like, kind of a poetic worship song. Like, imaginative.
Yeah.
I like it. It has a nice sound to it.
Such a great album.
Yeah, and then
such a great album.
Yeah, yeah, I like this. I don't want to get cynical and think he was just trying to follow up Great is the Lord and like, oh, I need another worship song. But like, this doesn't sound like a cash-in. It sounds like a genuinely poetic and good worship song.
Yeah.
So I dig this one a lot. I wish this one got to play in church that like Great is the Lord got.
Yeah.
Like, this would have been a good one to
sing.
Yeah,
this would have been a great one to sing.
And then he closes it out with what is basically Friends Part Deux. Pray for me. About someone who's going away, probably to be a missionary or something.
Probably. Let's see if we can get it to the hook. What's funny is each one of these songs, when I try and get to the chorus, the exact same point.
Oh, really?
Like, every time I slide the little thing, I slide it to the same point, and it's, like, starting. It's almost like his algorithm is like, okay, at the 109 part of every song is when the chorus is going.
This was definitely, if you weren't singing Friends when your youth pastor left, you were singing Pray For Me. Like,
when your youth pastor left.
Oh, yeah, because your youth pastor would go to take a job at a better church.
Yeah. That was totally.
And so you'd have a party to
Chris,
celebrate.
That may be the funniest thing you've ever said.
Well,
was hysterical. That it's totally right.
Yeah, they would like they'd be like, oh well, that's the money church. I wanna. Exactly. I've been toiling away at Northridge for so long, but I've got my eye on that Woodside money.
Right, I can get out of this apartment and I can get into a starter home.
Yeah. So you do the big party and you know have the dinner, the potluck dinner, and then. The youth group would sing Friends or Pray For Me or both. Like, it's a really good church. But I kind of like that song because, you know, I've heard people sing it when they leave a church. Again, things where you just don't announce that you're leaving, I guess. But I like that song. It's a nice little song to end on. And again, I don't think any of this, aside from the like weird trilogy of judgment in the middle of this, I don't think
which
this
I liked. I liked the trilogy. I liked
two of the three songs.
I don't like the fourth track. All You're Missing Is a Heartache. And I didn't like, what was the other one
Help
I didn't
Help You Find
like?
The Way?
Help You Find, no.
Oh, no, you like that.
Like
Live
that.
And Learn. That's what you
Live
like.
And Learn.
Yeah.
So 4 and 6 are out for me. Other than that, this whole album is fantastic. And it is, like I told you, I've added certain songs to new playlists. And it's definitely an album that I'm going to resurrect and listen to more often because I really enjoy it. I'd love to see if I could find it on vinyl.
There, maybe you can. There's a lot where I've gone back and listened to old Christian, especially since we've started doing this podcast and talked about it more.
I'm going
to
look it up right now on Amazon while you're talking.
I've gone back and listened to a lot of old stuff that I'm like, oh, this is going to hold up. This does not hold up. and surprisingly, there's some DC talk that is just flat out bad. But this is one of those ones where I kind of approached it the same way I approached Huey Lewis, where I was like, I'm going to laugh at this. And then I'm like, oh, wait, this is pretty great. I feel the same way about this. And
Chris, how much do you think on Amazon the vinyl for Eye to Eye is?
$80.
Higher.
$99.
Higher.
$200.
$200.
No way.
$200.
Wow. You got to get it.
Yeah, you guys keep sending in your.
We closed that down a long time ago.
And you bought your baseball hat that you're wearing with it.
My baseball hat was given to me by my work, but that paid for the posting of these wonderful podcast episodes. But we will start a new Kickstarter to get Joe his vinyl.
right.
So that is Eye to Eye, and it's an album that holds up.
Yeah,
I think you should choose the next album we do, and.
I don't know off the top of my head.
Don't pick it right now, but no. We'll do this every few weeks, and I think it's fun. And if you have albums,
actually, I think I know.
Yeah. Okay. Well, say it. Speak it.
We're gonna do the Prayer Chain Shawl.
Awesome. I have not heard that album.
Yeah.
So that'll be awesome. We will do that sometime in the next month.
Perfect.
We'll get that. And if you have suggestions for albums we need to talk about, or other weird Christian culture things that we should talk about, you know, I don't want to step on Good Christian Fun's toes, but I think we have a little different perspective than them. Send it our way at Facebook and tell us, if you've listened to this, tell us what you think about it. So we will be back next week, and I think we're talking movies. So we will see you then.
See you.